Welcome to e-Pathshala PG courses on computer science. We'll see about the next module, which where we'll discuss about the Java servlets. We'll see about the introduction of the Java servlets. The objective of this module is to know about the general architecture and the purpose of servlets. This module will learn about the servlet API that is supported with Java, and we'll also try to understand that how to create a basic servlet. So this servlet is actually a server-side programming technology. Any server-side program would receives the data from the web server. It would process the data and returns the output back to the web server, which would be given back to the web browser. So a server-side program is a one which should be requested to be processed when a client request is given. So the web browser would receives the data and would presents the data on the document once it receives the result from the web server. These server-side programs can be written in any language, but the current technologies, we can see that it is with the ASP, JSP and so on. And this servlet is one among the technology which is like an applet, but it would be written on the server side. So when you can understand about the servlets, servlets are platform independent server side software component, which is would be normally written in Java and which would dynamically extend the functionality of the server. So this gets executed on a Java enabled server. So specifically for Java, we have a server side scripting language which is now called as a servlet. So this would be a small server side software component, an independent component that is written in Java, and that would be executed on the server side by a request from the client. So we normally have a client server interaction. So this client is a web browser. From the web browser, we normally give a client would give a request to the server. The server in the server side, you will have a servlet program written, and this servlet program could be executed when a request is received by the server. And once a server servlet program gets executed, its results will be sent back to the web browser, or I mean that it is to the client, which would the data that is received by this client would be displayed on a web browser. Now to understand how does it work. So here we have a scenario of a client and a server. The client would send a request to the server, and the server would start the servlet. And the servlet computes the result for the server, and it would not quit. And the server returns the response back to the client. And if another client sends a request, the server calls the servlet again, and it would compute the result for the second client request. And again, it would not quit. And the whatever and result that is returned by the servlet would be sent by the server to the client. So here we need to compare it with the earlier model. The earlier technology for generating dynamically the web pages is for with like CGI scripts. So we have a server side scripting technology called CGI. CGI is normally it's called as a common gateway interface, and the and we know that this CGI would get executed on the server side. We normally write a CGI code with a C or a C++ or it can be with a Perl language and other languages to support CGI technology. And when you write a CGI code, that would be executed on the server side. So whenever a client request is given to a CGI code, a program, this would be created. For every client request, this CGI code would get executed and the result would be sent back to the client. So every time a client request is given, a new process would be created when a CGI code is written. So whereas when you look into the servlets once gets loaded, the servlet would be running as a background process. So every time a client gives a request, you will have a servlet running in the web server that would get executed or processed, and the results would be sent back to the client. So we have advantages over the servlet, like we have the processing speed or the resources utilized by the servlet is going to be minimum, and the processing speed is also of considerable performance. So we can see that this, when you run a servlet, this would not require creating a separate process each time. So once a servlet gets loaded in the memory, a servlet would stay in the memory and it does not have to be reloaded each time. So you will have only one instance that is handling multiple requests from multiple clients, and it is not like a separate instance that is created for every request when you write a CGA code. So when you write a CGA program, for every client request a new process would be created, whereas with servlets there would be only one servlet or one instance of the servlet that gets loaded into the memory would get executed for all the multiple client requests. So this obviously improves the performance of executing a server side code, and untrusted servlets can run in a sandbox. So but when you compare that, when you look into the disadvantages of the servlets, we have a less choice of languages, which means that your servlet program can be written only in Java. So Java supports a platform independent language. It's a platform independent language. So your servlet is going to be a platform independent Java component which would be running in the server side, and this servlet can be written only in a Java language, whereas when you look into a CGA, you have other options of writing the code in C, C++ or Perl or the other languages. So but when you compare the performance of a servlet with CGA, servlets has a considerable performance in terms of the processing speed and the memory or the resources that is utilized in the server side. Now in order to execute the servlet, we need to go for a web container, or you can call it a web server. We know that there are web browsers. Normally we have instances like Firefox or Google Chrome, Internet Explorer. All these are instances of a web browser. But from the web browser, we normally gives a request to the server. So you need to have a web browser installed in the client side in order to handle this client request and to be sent to the server. So all these requests would be sent as a HTTP request, and the response from the server would be written back as a HTTP response. All these preliminaries we have already seen in the earlier modules. Now, in order to execute a servlet, we need to have a servlet engine. So this servlet engine is nothing but a web server that has to be installed in the server side. So here we have a web server called Tomcat. This comes along with the Apache, and Tomcat is a like a helper application for Apache, and it acts as a servlet container. So this Tomcat is a servlet engine that handles servlet requests for Apache. So now this Apache can handle many types of web services compared to Tomcat, and when you can this Tomcat is added one with Apache. So either we can install Apache as a standalone one, or you can install Tomcat as a standalone one, or you can have both Apache and Tomcat together for supporting web services as well as for executing servlets. And we know that this Apache can be installed without a Tomcat, and a Tomcat can also be installed without this Apache. So it is not necessary that you need to have an Apache installed in your machine to run your servlets. But we need a web container or a web server. That is, now we'll see, we can see in the coming slides how we normally have to install a Tomcat to run our servlet code. So it's very easier to install Tomcat standalone than as part of the Apache. So by itself we can see Tomcat can handle web pages, servlets and JSP. So in order to work with all these technologies, we need to have a Tomcat installed in our server machine. And both this Tomcat and Apache are open source. That is, we mean that it is freely available. So we need to run a servlet code or a servlet program. We need to have a web server installed in our machine. And we, as we know that this client and server can run in a single machine. The thing is that our servlet would be running in the web server, or it gets loaded into the address space of the web server. So now coming to the API that is supported for executing servlets. So in Java, in order to execute servlets, we have a separate API, servlet API, that has two specific packages called javax.servlet and javax.servlet.http. So these two packages contains the classes and the interface in order to write a servlet code. And these packages doesn't come along with the Java core packages, so they are not included in the JSDK, that is the Java Software Development Kit. So now, but nowadays in the earlier versions of JDK, we don't have this servlet API. So we need to separately get the package put into our JDK in order to run our servlet program. But nowadays in the recent versions, we can see that along with JDK, we have the servlet API. So the servlet API, it's available as a jar file that has to be downloaded and put into the library of the JDK. So that servlet API has got two packages to support for writing servlet programs. So the two packages are javax.servlet and javax.servlet.http. So in order to start coding our servlet program, the first step we have to import these two packages, which has the classes and the interfaces supported for writing a servlet code. Now let us see what is this package contains. So the servlet API consists of this package called javax.servlet, and this in this servlet javax.servlet package, we have five interfaces like servlet, and we have the servlet request interface, servlet response, servlet context, and the servlet config. So this servlet interface declares the lifecycle methods for a servlet, and the servlet request interface would help the servlet to read data from a client request, and servlet response interface is to write a response or a data back to the client. And using the servlet context interface, we can enable the servlet to log events and access information about the environment. And we have another interface called servlet config interface, which would allow the servlets to get the initialization parameters. So these five interfaces are available in the package called javax.servlet. And the other package called javax.servlet.http, this specifically contains these three interfaces called HTTP servlet request, HTTP servlet response, and HTTP session. All these three are defined as interfaces. And HTTP servlet request would enable the servlet to read data from an HTTP request, and HTTP servlet response would enable the servlet to write data to an HTTP response. And there is an interface called HTTP session, this for handling session management or session tracking with servlets. So this interface would allow session data to be read and written. So these are the important interfaces we need to know when we have the servlet API. So a servlet is any class that implements the javax.servlet.servlet interface. So this API provides two abstract classes that implements the servlet interface called generic servlet and HTTP servlet. So mostly when you create a servlet, you will extend the class with a HTTP servlet class, or you will implement, you will extend it with the generic servlet class. So some servlets would extend this generic servlet class, and mostly we are from the web browser, a request would be sent as a HTTP request and the response is sent back as a HTTP response. So we normally create a servlet by extending the HTTP servlet class. So this HTTP servlet class is a class that is implementing the interface called servlet interface. Now, as I told you, this servlet interface provides the lifecycle methods of the servlet. So the lifecycle methods of the servlet consists of the methods like init, service, and destroy. And other than these three lifecycle methods, we have the method called getServletConfig, which returns the ServletConfig object. And we have another method called getServletInformation, which returns the servlet information as a string object. So servlets like applets usually lack a main method. So we must implement or override other methods like init, service, and destroy. So they don't have a main method. So like applet, they don't have a main method. Instead, we have to override the service method or the other methods that is given for supporting servlets. Now let us take a brief look of the different methods that are provided in the other interfaces. So as I told you, the servlet interface has got the lifecycle methods. The servlet request interface is used to read the data from the servlets, from the request. So servlet request interface has got a method called get parameter that would actually return the string object or the value of the parameter by giving the parameter name. So get parameter is a method that gets the parameter name and it would returns the value of the parameter. So this is to read the data from the request. And we have a method called get parameter values. This would read the parameter, will get the parameter name and can return an array of string objects. So that would contain all the values of the request parameter. And there is another method called get parameter names that returns an enumeration containing all the parameter names as string objects. So now the servlet request, from the servlet request, you can use these methods to read the value of the parameters. And there are two more methods called get remote host. This returns a string that specifies the full qualified name of the computer from where we get the request. And there is another method called get remote address that returns a string that specifies the IP address of the computer from which the request has been sent. So there are other methods too, but some of the methods we commonly make use of is the one I have listed here. So, and we have another response called servlet response. So I have told you about the servlet interface, servlet request interface, and now I am telling you about the servlet response interface. So servlet response interface define methods called servlet get output stream that returns the output stream to send the binary data as response. And we have a method called get writer. This returns the print writer objects. So this is for the servlet uses this method to send character data as response. And you have a method called set content type for setting the content type for the servlet response. You can set the MIME type for a servlet response like text or plain, image or JPEG, and text bar, text or HTML. And you have method like set content length by which you can set the content length for the response. And servlet context is another interface which has methods like set attribute and get attribute. This is for binding the objects with a name and a value pair as an attribute to the servlet context object. And we have the method like get attribute names in the servlet context interface. This returns an enumeration of the string object that contains the name of all the context attributes. So in order to read the context, the information about the context attributes, you can come across these methods, get attribute names. And there is a method called get init parameter. This returns the value of the initialization parameter with the name passed as a parameter. And there is a method called get init parameter names. This returns an enumeration of string object that contains the name of all the initialization parameters. So get init parameter is for reading the value of one single one. Get init parameter names is to read the names of all the parameters, initialization parameters. And as I told you, you have another interface called HTTP servlet request interface. This comes with the next package called javax.servlet.http. So in the second package, we have interfaces like HTTP servlet request, HTTP servlet response, and HTTP session. So this HTTP servlet request interface has got a method like get header. This returns the value of the request header field that is normally specified by the parameter name. So you give the parameter name that gets the you can read the header value of the header. And get headers would return all the values associated with the request field. And get header names would returns the names of all the request header that a servlet can access as an enumeration of the string objects. So this returns an enumeration of string objects. And HTTP servlet response interface has got methods like set header and set int header. So set header would set the value of the header by giving the name of the parameter and the value of the parameter, and get int header would set the value of the header along with the value. But if the header field has been set, the new value overwrites the existing value. So this is for setting with an int value, integer value. There is methods like in the HTTP servlet response interface, we have methods like set date header. So this sets the value of the header along with the date value. So date represents the date in milliseconds. And add header would add a header with the header name and a value. So this would add a new header if the header already exists. And add int header would add a header with a name and an integer value. So now the various methods that are defined in the HTTP servlet response would be add date header. So this add date header would add the header with the date value, and contents header would return true if the header has been already set with a specific value, and it would be false if not set. And send redirect would redirect the request to the specified URL. So these are the methods that are defined in the HTTP servlet response interface. And HTTP session interface has got methods like set attribute and get attribute and get attribute names. Set attribute would be for, as I told you, this HTTP session interface is for session tracking with servlets. So you can maintain a session, and so during that session you can set an attribute. So you can bind the object with a name and a value as an attribute to the session object, HTTP session object. And get attribute, by giving the string name, by giving the string object, this can retrieve the value of the parameter from the session object. And get attributes name would return an enumeration that contains the name of all the objects that are bound as attributes to the HTTP session object. Now coming to this generic servlet, as I told you, you have two classes called generic servlet and HTTP servlet. So when you want to write a servlet program, you have to extend it with this generic servlet class, or you have to extend it with the HTTP servlet class. So this generic servlet defines a generic protocol independent servlet, and this normally gives a blueprint and that makes writing servlet easier. So generic servlet would provide simple versions of the lifecycle methods like init and destroy, and of some of the methods in the servlet config interface. So to write a generic servlet, we have to override the abstract method called service method. So you define a class that extends generic servlet, and we have to override the method called service method. So within the service method, you will write your executable code. So this service method would take two parameters. One is the servlet request object, the other one is the servlet response object. So this would provide access to the generic server request and response. So the other way to write a servlet is to extend the HTTP servlet class. So there are two classes, generic servlet class and HTTP servlet class. So this HTTP servlet class is extended to add the HTTP specific functionality. So we normally handle HTTP request and response. These web browsers handles HTTP request and responses. So we need to write a class that extends this HTTP servlet class. And this is an abstract class that extends the generic servlet. So it is necessary to extend the HTTP servlet. So web-based servlets typically extends the class HTTP servlet, and HTTP servlet overrides the service method and provides additional methods like doGet and doPost. So these doGet and doPost methods, these are the two methods we override when you are extending a class with HTTP servlet. So these two methods takes HTTP servlet request object and then HTTP servlet response object as parameters. And these methods can throw servlet exception or IO exception. So now coming to the lifecycle of a servlet, as I told you, there are three methods that defines the lifecycle of the servlet. So we have a method called init, and we have a method called service, and we have a method called destroy. So this init method is to initialize the servlet, and once the servlet is initialized, the service method would be called. So if any request comes to the server, then it calls the service method. The service method is to process the client request, and before that servlet to be destroyed. The destroy method would be called. This is for destroying the servlet. So the container would call the destroy method to terminate any servlet. So now it becomes unavailable, that is the instance is destroyed and it would be marked for garbage collection. So Java provides automatic garbage collection. So now coming to this init method, when a servlet is first started up, this init method would be invoked. So the method declaration is like this: init, it takes a servlet config. So this method would be invoked immediately after a servlet is loaded into the servlet engine, that is our web server. So when the first request comes to the servlet, it gets loaded into the address space of the web server. So it is getting loaded into the memory of the web server and the servlet would get configured. So to the init method, we have the servlet config object by which the servlet gets configured, and once it is loaded, the servlet is available in the web server that is running as a process, and every servlet request would result in a call to the service method. This service method takes two parameters as servlet request and servlet response. So this throws servlet exception and IO exception. So this is for processing a servlet request, and it can be called any number of times, 0 or any number of times. So multiple requests can be handled by the service method. So multiple threads can execute this method in parallel, so it must be thread safe. And when the servlet is shut down, the destroy method is called. The method signature is like this: public void destroy. So once the servlet gets unloaded, it is marked for garbage collection. So looking into the architecture diagram, we can see in your JVM you have the servlet container, and this servlet container would initiate a call to the servlet. So the servlet invoke the method called init method when the servlet gets first loaded and the first request is received by the servlet. And for every subsequent request call, the service method would be called. And finally, when the servlet is destroyed, the destroy method would be invoked. So now this HTTP request can be of two forms: either it can be a GET request or a POST request. So we have seen that when a request is submitted in a web page, it is almost a GET request. So all the information that is passed from the client side is added to the URL. So the URL, you can see there would be a question mark, and following the question mark you have the parameters that are attached in the URL, and that would be sent to the server. But this GET request is for putting only limited information. So you can also put large amount of information if your request is going to be a PUT request. And there is another request called POST request, by which also you can send it as a separate, it is not along with the request, with the URL, but as a separate header you can send the request to the server. There are other types of methods, request called delete, get, head, options, POST, put and trace. So this GET request is normally dispatched to the DOGET method of the HTTP servlet, and a POST request would be dispatched to the DOPOST. So when you call, both of them are typically doing the same thing. So when you call the DOGET, when you make use of a POST method, it is directed to the DOPOST method. So from the DOPOST method can be invoked within the DOGET method. So this actually both of them are doing the same thing. You can either write with a DOGET or you can do with a DOPOST. So your executable statements can be written within this DOPOST, and that could be called from a DOGET method. So now we can summarize that in this module we have actually discussed about the purpose of servlets. We have seen about the architecture of the servlets, we have seen the life cycle of the servlets, and we have also seen about the API, servlet API. So the different interfaces and the classes that would help us to write a servlet program. Thank you.